Where have you all been? I apologize. It's been kind of a... I was driving home from... home from my sister's house in York, Pennsylvania, yesterday. And I got almost to Harrisburg, and the car just stopped. Fortunately, I was only an hour away, so my mother was able to come and my sister and let me borrow one of their cars, and who knows what will happen with it. Hopefully, it might be fixed. It might not. It's kind of old, you know. We'll see. Got to go with the punches sometimes, right? A couple of announcements this morning. First of all, next Saturday, we will be participating in the lighting, the tree lighting ceremony with the Brookline community. And that, one of the things that involves is that we have allowed them to use our space in Musil Hall for some vendors to set up. So there'll be a bunch of vendors set up. We will have the Backyard Angel open, and I think this is from 12 to 5, if I remember correctly. And there's going to be a variety of other things that are going on up and down the avenue, but we could really use a couple of volunteers, and quite frankly, it won't be difficult. It's just a matter of you being there, right? Just to have some folks who can help out with the Backyard Angel and who can help out if the vendors have any questions about where's a bathroom or that kind of stuff. So there are no prerequisites for you to volunteer. There's no training necessary. So even if you can if you can't come for the whole time, but could come for a couple hours, that would be great, because there's just, you know, poor Cheryl has taken on so much to be a part of this and make this, you know, something that allows us to express our love to the community. And of course, we ourselves will have a table, and we will be putting out all of the many different activities that are happening during the season of Advent and Christmas, that we want to invite people to come and share in all of those things. So it's an opportunity for evangelism. And just helping to make St. Mark's known to perhaps some young people or new people in the neighborhood. Secondly, I want to note that right outside my office, there is now a sign-up sheet. And the sign-up sheet is for ushers, okay, for each week, because somehow, you know, it seems like we don't have ushers at certain times, and so we just have to grab somebody. So if you would like to volunteer to be an usher, please, you know, just sign up. But even more importantly, I think, for acolytes, okay? So anyone who is willing to serve as an acolyte, particularly our youth, the sign-up sheet is right outside my door, and you can just sign up for 4 or 5 different times that work for you, okay? So I would greatly appreciate that. That's the following week. Okay. We have Tuesday Bible study, of course, because that's every week, but do we have pub theology? Is Tuesday a first or third Tuesday of the month, or were we still in November as of Tuesday? We're still in November. Okay. So then the pub theology is not this week; it's the following week. And for those of you for whom we sent out the article, we're just going to use the same one that got canceled a couple weeks ago because of snow. Okay, okay. So yes, I think it already did, like you say. But if any of you can't find that email, just let Paul know. Thank you, Paul. My sermon's up there. Good. Thank you for writing that this morning, Paul. I appreciate that you got up at 4 o'clock to write that, and appreciate even more that you knew how to get it off my computer. Any other announcements from the congregation? Yes, Cheryl. Mm-hmm.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
In the back of the church is a list of all the dates of things that are happening, but I have a few new ones to add to it, like there's not enough on here. Like Pastor said, next Saturday they are having the vendor fair, and it is from 12 to 5, and we are still looking for bodies to sit at the table to talk to everybody there about St. Mark's and all the wonderful things that are going on. Backyard Angel is going to be open. We're kind of doing a program called Keep Brookline Warm. Brookline Together, the community group, is going to put it out there that if you have any gently used coats, if you want to drop them off, because our coat supply is dwindling fast. And we know as the winter goes on, people are going to be looking for more coats. Also, we have an abundance of scarves and hats and gloves, so we are going to have them hanging or displayed for the taking during the vendor fair. They may be outside if the weather's not, you know, if it's raining or heaven forbid, no snow going on, then we'll have them available inside. And we thought that would be a nice way to share with the neighborhood, and then they can, you know, help to deplete some of our stock and bring some notice to Backyard Angel. And like Pastor said, we need volunteers for both events. Backyard Angel, it's very easy. All you have to do is sit at a table and welcome people when they come in and answer any questions. There's only 3 rooms that we deal with, so it's not hard. Also on the 4th is the Lady Lions, and anybody else that would like to go to the movie? Pardon me? Oh, were you gonna bring that up? Okay, yeah, on the 4th is the movie. The movie's at 4 o'clock. We're gonna meet here at 3 o'clock. We can carpool for anybody that needs a ride down and back. And then on the 10th is our regular Backyard Angel Saturday. So that one we will be open from 9 to 1, our normal hours. The one on the 3rd, we will be open the same as the vendor hours, which is 12 to 5. And then also that same day at the same time, we're going to have breakfast at the manger. There are sign-up sheets in the hall also for both Backyard Angels and the manger, and for the vendor fair. So if you can lend a hand, even if you can just give us an hour, that would be great. All are welcome. And I think that's all the changes I had.
Been downstairs to see Backyard Angel. We have so much stuff, and it is so incredibly well placed together. I mean, pretty much the entire basement is filled with clothes, and from children, you know, of course, men's and women's, and all the way up. So Cheryl's worked so hard, and I know she's had some volunteers that have helped her, but please, come and check it out. Everything is free, as you know. We don't charge anybody anything. This is just our way of giving back to the community. We haven't talked about, I should just take a moment to mention that on Saturday, December 10th, what we're calling Breakfast at the Manger from 9 to 1, and the Backyard Angel is also going to be open at the same time. The idea is that we, you know, we've been talking to lots of mothers. We have so much children's clothes. We want them to just, you know, make sure their children have coats and scarves and hats and gloves. So there's a ton of children's stuff out there. But we also wanted to provide the parents with an opportunity to spend some time and go through everything at Backyard Angel. And you know, there might be some children who are not so excited about that. So we're going to have a set up in Mesa Hall, a place to eat and to do a craft and to watch some Christmas movies for the very young people. So if any of those things are things that you would be willing to help with, again, we would very much appreciate it. I assume that everyone did receive a paper with everything that's happening from now until January 5th. I'm not even going to talk about that because you probably don't. I don't know that anyone here, as far as I knew, was aware of what they call Twelfth Night, January 5th, the last day of Christmas. We're going to celebrate that here too. Everything on there. Not only do we invite you, but we encourage you to invite a friend or neighbor. Okay, and by next week, I'm going to have some cards to give out for you. We're going to give 10 cards to every person, and these are cards that are going to be all printed for you. All you got to do is sign your name, address it, put a stamp on it, and send them out. And Paul asked me how many to make. I said 500. So everybody's getting 10, and I promise I'll do at least 50. So, you know, he's printing off a lot of these, and really, this is one of the most easiest ways of evangelism, is to just be able to share what's happening here at St. Mark's. Any other announcements today? Yes.
I'm inviting and asking all of you to, for your prayer list, to add Diane and Dan Crown. That's Bonnie and Dawn Coaster's daughter and son-in-law. We visited them to deliver Meals on Wheels on last Tuesday, and we found out that Dan, who is suffering from cancer, was going outside of their apartment and tripped and fell. And he fell forward, and he broke his neck. And at this time, they're not going to do anything with the neck that they can, because they're believing that he's not going to be with us much longer. So please consider them in your prayers. And also, I got a update on Della Musich. She's not doing well with her therapy as of now. So please continue to keep them in your prayer.
Thank you. And that's Diane and Dan. Is that correct? Crown? Okay. Paul, if I don't think they are any longer on our mailing or in our church directory. So if you could get from Ray their mailing address, I'd like to send it out to the whole congregation so we can at least send them a card. We can send them a card and let them know that they are in our prayers. Any other announcements? Yes, David.
You could probably figure out whenever we have an annual meeting, the council meets to reorganize itself. And in the past, we've kind of done it in the hallway or pastor's office, but I've not done that because I wanted us all to be together and have Zoom running. So I wanted to let the council know that our first meeting, which will be December 13th, is when we'll have the essentially reorganization meeting. That's when we elect the president and people indicate whether they want to keep in the same committee or not.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, David. Anyone else? Do we any God sightings this week? Okay, come on up, Gene. You know, and I know sometimes this seems like, oh my gosh, can't we just start to worship? I'll tell you right now, when the God sightings, I think, is the best part of worship. It is, because, I mean, that's why we're here, right? That's why we're here, to proclaim the gospel and how Jesus spoke to us this week.
I'm going to give you a wonderful God sighting today. See my shirt? Jesus is the reason for the season. We can get so distracted with so many other things. This is God's gift coming to us, and he's our Savior. What a wonderful thing. And when you're trying to make the cookies and do all the things that we do and buy the gifts, remember, even if we give a gift to somebody, think of Jesus and the love that he brings to us, because that's the reason for the season. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Jean. Anyone else this morning? Yes. Come on up, please, Joni.
On our neighborhood watch, I guess everybody has it everywhere, and it was in Scott Township, and there was an invitation for last Wednesday. It was a Thanksgiving invitation to go to Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. So my husband and I decided to go. It was such a blessing. There was a Presbyterian minister there, a rabbi, a Catholic priest, a Methodist minister, and there was one more, some kind of charity church or something it was. And they all talked about what everybody was thankful for in each and every church. It was so wonderful to be there and to listen and see so many people from all the different congregations together. It was just an eye-opening in how we're all the same, and how even they say we all need to get together and pray together. So it was really a sighting for my husband and I. It was something we really enjoyed.
That's great. Thank you. I pass that church and go through Scott Township twice a day to take my son to work and pick him up. So I know exactly where you're talking about. And that reminds me that actually this afternoon at 4 o'clock, St. Teresa of Calcutta, of Calcutta, not Teresa of Calcutta, but Calcutta, their parish, they are having an ecumenical prayer service and dinner afterwards. And everyone is invited. I will need to find out myself where it's located. Does anybody know? It might be up in Beechwood. Beechview. Okay. It's the church is called St. Catherine's, but the parish is called St. Teresa of Calcutta. Okay. And that's 4 o'clock this afternoon, if you would like to come and experience. Again, it's a ecumenical a prayer service that's designed for people of all faiths. And so I just commend them for doing that. Any other God sightings today that people would want to share? Okay, then I just want to also not forget to say hello to our sisters and brothers who are watching online, and let us take a moment now to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Please stand as you are able. The Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin and whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. With a heart full of compassion and mercy, God saves us and forgives us. Christ, the dawn from on high, shines upon us, and by the light of the Holy Spirit, guides our feet into the way of peace. Amen. Before we begin the gathering hymn, I just want to announce, so the service is totally new to get today. Some of it is you know, things that you know very well. But, you know, the previous service we had used, I think, since, September. This service, we will use the same service through the seasons of Advent, Christmas, and Epiphany. So it's designed to bring our awareness to things like waiting, the incarnation of Jesus in the flesh, and the light of the Lord, which shines upon us always. So let's now sing our gathering hymn, Day by Day. Day by day, Lord, attend me, bring in when I call, O Lord, to you in prayer. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
My soul proclaims your greatness, Lord.
You can sit on the chair right there, and I'll motion to you when it's time.
Now every land and every age, the blessing shall proclaim. Great wonders you have done for me, and holy is your name. To Israel is your servant blessed, your help is ever sure. The promise to our parents made, their children will secure. Sing glory to the Holy One, give honor to the Word, and praise the power of the Most High, one God by all adored.
So what song does that, or what scripture does this song remind us of? Why would we be using it during the season of Advent and Christmas? It's the song of Mary, right? This is the song that Mary sang when the angel came and told her that she would bear the Son of God. And so that's why we use this particular song for Advent and Christmas. Let us pray together, or let us pray. I will pray the prayer of the day. Faithful God, you proved your faithfulness to your people when they cried out to you in distress. Be present in our distress and show us how to be faithful to you in the midst of even suffering. We praise these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now we will have the lighting of the first Advent candle as the congregation sings the melody.
Light one candle to watch for Messiah. Let the light banish darkness. He shall bring salvation to Israel. God fulfills the promise.
And now the congregation may be seated as we continue with the reading of God's holy word for us today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading for today is from Habakkuk, assorted chapters and verses. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw, O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen, or cry to you, violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, judgment comes forth perverted. Look at the nations and see. Be astonished. Be astonished. For a work is being done in your days that you would not believe if you were told. For I am rousing the Chaldeans, that fierce and impetuous nation, who march through the breadth of the earth to seize dwellings not their own. Dread and fearsome are they. Their justice and dignity proceed from themselves. I will stand by my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it, and it will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. Though the fig tree does not blossom and no fruit is on the vines, though produce of the olive fails and the fields yield no food, though the flock is cut off from the fold and there is no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will exalt in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer and makes me tread upon the heights to the leader with stringed instruments. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus, come, for we invite you, guest and master, friend and Lord. Give your gifts, command your servants, speak and let us hear your word. Lead us through our need or doubting, hope be born and joy restored.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 26th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus went with the disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me. The Gospel of the Lord. Congregation may be seated. And I invite our young people to come up for a moment this morning. We're going to improvise this morning. Here you go. You can sit on the bench. I couldn't have coordinated that if I had tried, could I? Well, you know what, actually, that's, you helped me make the point today, Robbie, because what's all this stuff up here? You brought this junk in, huh? What's it look like?
Like before Jesus was born?
Yeah,
when Jesus was born. Do you know what we call these? Each of these different scenes of that show about Jesus, do you know what we call them? We call this, some people call them nativity set, and the nativity in Latin, well, and even actually still almost in Spanish, nativity means birth, the birth. So we call them nativity scenes, or some people refer to them as a creche. Just depends what part of the country you grew up in. But all of these are what people have brought from their houses. And I'm going to bless these all today. And I hope you will help me bless them. And then they will take them back home and put them out in their houses as we wait for, what's that day called? You know what I'm talking about. Towards the end of December.
Christmas?
Oh, yeah, right. That's it, Christmas, yeah. And so these help people mark the times toward Christmas. When I had children your age, we would set up like just the manger 1 week, and then maybe the next week we bring in Mary, and the next Sunday we'd bring in Joseph, and then we bring in some animals. And I did that to help my children understand how this whole story about the birth of Jesus worked. Okay, now you can turn around this way. And I forgot my other prop. But my other prop was a crown. A crown like a king wears, you know? Don't you think I deserve a crown? Huh? I have crowns on my chasuble. I went out, oh man, it cost me so much money at Burger King. And I got one of those crowns. And I was going to wear it today and ask you what I looked like, but alas, it didn't make it into the sanctuary today. But the point I was going to make with it is that for Christians, Jesus is our King. Jesus is always the most important person in our lives, you know, along with our family and friends and everyone else. But Jesus is really, you know, he's clutch. He's clutch. You know what I mean by clutch? Good, because my kids didn't, and they're 20. And 21, 22. I called myself Clutch Daddy, you know, this week, and they didn't even know where I'm at. So Jesus is clutch, all right? He's up there. He's got it going on. And so does Orion. Come on up. Come on up, join. You can join. Yeah. You're almost there. Okay, yay! All right, good job. Okay, now you can turn around again, and I am going to bless these nativity scenes, and I just invite you to watch, and can you hold your hands out over them? Put your hands out over the table, and lean forward a little, and put them up a little bit higher, like there's power and energy coming from your hands, going into all of these creches, which belong to our church members, and they want them to be special and be powerful this holy season. Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise that through the story of the birth of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we are given insight into why he came to be with us and the powerful ministry that he had as he touched people's lives. And so, Lord, we remember all these things as we look forward to your Nativity on Christmas Eve, as we are reminded that the one who comes to us is not only blessed, but is your Son. And so now, O Lord, we ask that you would bless all of these nativities, and that they might help to tell the story of the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, you can go back. Because your nativities too, because you also help to tell the story of Jesus, right? Okay, thank you for being with me this morning. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from our living God and from our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. How long, O Lord? How long? That's what the prophet Isaiah cried to the Lord in desperation. He asked that question which maybe not in that form, but certainly in our minds is the same question. How long, Lord, is this crap going to keep going? How long do we have to turn on the television and see the victims of mass murder? How long, O Lord? The prophet Isaiah was speaking to the people of Jerusalem, who once again find themselves under the threat of attack. They are living in danger and fear of being overtaken or even destroyed. But this time, it is not like fear of the Assyrians, which, if you remember, was last week's gospel lesson between the prophet Isaiah and King Hezekiah. That's what they had to deal with, which is about 80 years earlier than today's gospel. This time it's fear of the new world superpower, the Chaldeans, or perhaps better known as the Babylonians. So now, just two generations later than last week's lesson, where the prophet Isaiah was advising King Hezekiah as the Assyrians were threatening Jerusalem. Now, this week, it's the prophet Habakkuk, which you did a great job, Cheryl, of pronouncing that. I have heard all kinds of stuff come from people's man, you know, Habakkuk, you know, that's not a very good pronunciation for a king, and you said it fast, and that's what I always say. If there's a word you don't know, just say it fast. No one will ever catch it. So now, two generations later than our lesson last week, we have the prophet Habakkuk, who is called to advise King Joachim. And he's called to advise him about the threat of the Chaldeans or Babylonians. Now, allow me to stop for a moment and point out the primary job of a prophet. Because I think most of us, certainly I did growing up, had a totally different sense of what prophets really did back, 2,500 years ago, and what we think they did, today. The There were three primary roles that a prophet, an Old Testament prophet, played. The first is that the prophet was a messenger of God, right? And probably most of you have heard that, that was what they did. They were a messenger from God. So they helped to communicate God's will to the people. Second, the prophets were to be an advisor to the king, right? They really were part of the king's staff, and they were to be an advisor to the king, not only with spiritual matters, but more essentially on matters related to war, because war was so ubiquitous in those days. And because the king was charged to discern God's will for the people of Jerusalem, or the people, the nation of Babylon, whoever it was, the king was called to discern, is this a good strategy? Is this a good practice? Right? Something that we want to do. Do we really want to go to war with this, other nation? How many soldiers do they have versus how many soldiers do we have? Right? Do you know prophets? That was part of their role. Did you know that? It's almost like the role of Secretary of State, right? In the United States, because what does our Secretary of State do? They, part of their job is to know, right, all of the details about our opponents and their strategies and the what they are capable of doing with their army. That was part of what a prophet did. And then finally, the third aspect of the prophet's job was to serve as a mediator and arbitrator between the common folks, like you and me, and the more influential classes, the wealthy class, the political class. The prophet's job was to let people know when they were acting in opposition to God's will. It was the prophet's job to let people know when what they were doing was hypocritical. To have this fancy worship on Sunday morning. Sorry, you can't see this. I'm swiggling my hips up here. But, if you could see through this, you would see me dancing. Right? That we have this fancy worship on Sunday morning, and then we go home on Sunday night and Monday morning, and it's like same old, right? It's the prophet's job to let people know when they were acting in opposition to God's will, when they were being hypocritical by having this glorious, fancy worship on the Sabbath, but then we fail to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God, which Susan preached about 2 weeks ago. That's the third element of the prophet's job. So Habakkuk has been in conversation as the prophet. He's been in conversation with God. He's gotten intelligence information about the enemy, and now he reports his advice to the king. So, last week we had the story of Isaiah and King Hezekiah, and them deciding what are they going to do about the Assyrians. This week we have the story of Habakkuk and King Joachim about a potential conflict with the Chaldeans or the Babylonians. there's one major difference this week from last week. Because otherwise, it could have been the same story. There's one major difference. Last week, it was King Hezekiah, and he was very faithful. Faithful to God. King Hezekiah was very faithful to Yahweh, the God of Israel. On the other hand, King Joachim, who we're talking about this morning, he was one hot mess. Frankly, King Joachim was a player. You know what it means to be for a man to be a player? Huh? Right? That means that they're, you know, they don't settle down. They're out with all different kinds of women. They're doing whatever they want in their lives. That was King Joachim. He was a player and was rarely, rarely faithful to God. King Joachim, unlike King Hezekiah, King Joachim did not fully trust in the God of Israel. Joachim felt it would be better to cover his bases and to follow and pray to all the gods. And oh my goodness, there were many, many gods. Each country, you know, had their own god. Each country had maybe even had two or three gods. And so King Joachim thinks that, well, you know what? If I pray to all of them, then, you know, maybe I've covered all my bases. Just in case I need a backup plan and Yahweh, our God, doesn't come through for me. Well, then I can, you know, then I can kneel down in front of the God of Babylon and see if that God would come through for us. Well, you know, that doesn't sit very well with the first commandment. I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before you. You know, I think of it kind of like relief pitchers. Now, this is slightly off the subject, but I remember when starting pitchers were expected to last at least 7 innings, and normally 8 innings, and possibly even a complete game through the 9th inning, right? When's the last time you've seen a baseball pitcher even make it to the 7th inning? Right? Now the expectation is make it through the 5th inning. That's for the starting pitcher. And then we have a bullpen full of relief pitchers that will, you know, that we'll come in with. That seemed to me to be Joachim's strategy, right? Well, if the God of Israel gets me through half the war, but then I start losing, then I'll start praying to a different God and see if I can have a better outcome. But getting back to that battle, potential military battle, between King Joachim and the king of Babylon, who was Nebuchadnezzar, God tells the prophet Habakkuk what needs to be done. And this is what God says. God says, the people need a vision. They need to know their purpose in life. They need a clear mission statement. God tells Habakkuk to provide the people with a vision. And he says specifically, write the vision down for all to see. And he continues, and I love this, make it plain. In other words, don't use fancy words. You know, don't try and you know, fluff up your own ego and you know, and talk about this vision statement or this mission statement for the people that's, you know, that they don't even understand. make it plain. If you ever been to a Baptist church or actually many African American congregations, you know, the pastor will say, typically somewhere in the middle of the sermon, I'm gonna make it plain, which means I'm gonna tell it like it is. I'm not gonna use all flowery fluff. And that's where it came from, right here. I'm gonna make it plain, because that's what God tells Habakkuk to do. That even somewhere, someone running along the road could see it and understand it. So let's go back to the beginning just for a closing moment. Habakkuk cries out to God, "How long, O Lord? How long? How long does my child have to suffer? How long will the people of Ukraine suffer?" I've mentioned before, I have a couple of friends in Ukraine, and used to get emails. I mean, you emails back and forth almost every day. Now I'm lucky, and they live in Kiev, the capital city, right? Now I'm lucky if I hear from them once a week, or if they're able to get back to me once a week, because all the electricity has been bombed. No, you know, they're only able to get electricity very sporadically for a couple of hours. The Russians have bombed all of their energy plants. So there's no heat. And there's no gas, so stores can't receive new supplies for people. How long must that go on, oh God? You know, it's been going on since February. People have been decimated. Frankly, it's a genocide. How long will racism and homophobia and the marginalization of different religions and cultures, whether they be Jewish, or right here in Pittsburgh, or whether they be an imam in a mosque? How long? How long do we have to put up with these damn mass murders? You know how many mass murders there have been in the last 10 days? Anybody have an idea? Yes? Just guess. Five. Higher. Eight. Higher. Ten. Higher. Not quite 100, thank God. Not quite 100. But there have been 18. 18 mass murders in the last 10 days. And let me tell you, so a mass murder is described as four or more people being shot by the same person, and whether they end up dead or alive. Anytime four or more people are shot. We've had 18 of them across the United States. Where have they happened? There have been three of them in Texas. There have been three of them in Illinois. There have been two of them in Virginia. There have been also in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia, in Maryland, in Florida, there have been two, in Georgia, in Alabama, in Missouri, 18. 36 people died from those in the last 10 days, and 63 were injured. What do we need to do so that our police are not outgunned than the population? There is no godly reason why the population needs, you know, AK-15s or AR-15s, whatever the heck they call them, when our police officers can't even carry those. In fact, they're weapons of war. If you're a soldier, great, fine. I salute you, I applaud you, I thank you. But sure as hell, there's no reason I need one. How long until children around the world would stop dying of hunger? So here's another question. Anybody? Guess how many children, this is defined as people under five, or kids under five, die every day as a result of malnutrition and hunger. How many do you think? Every day. I'm sorry.
Hundreds.
Yep. Go up. Thousands. 4,000 children, just children, a day die of hunger. That is twice the number of people killed in 9/11 every day. Two 9/11s every day. And it doesn't have to be that way. I'm going to jump ahead and finish up here. Partly because it just grieves me so. It just grieves my spirit. St. Francis had a phrase, and many of you know I'm working on becoming what's considered a Lutheran Franciscan. We have particular vows we have to take and so forth. But so I've been doing a lot of studying of St. Francis. And St. Francis said, preach the gospel always. Use words when necessary. In other words, what is it that we do in the world that brings glory and honor to God and to Jesus? We live as people who follow Jesus each and every day. You know, I think that oftentimes, I don't know where my bulletin is now. Oh, no. I think that often, you know, it's good for us to recite the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed. You'll notice this week we're using, and for now the next couple months, we'll be using the Nicene Creed. But, you know, even if we can say we assent, we believe, we accept everything that it says, I think God just rolls her eyes. Preach the gospel always. God, you know, God is much more interested in how we do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with her and with him. That's why Martin Luther used to talk about, or actually not just talked about, he introduced and you know, this new, very foreign concept of the priesthood of all believers. Do you know how radical that was in Luther's day? Luther used to talk about many of the priests, and he was one in the Catholic Church. He talked about them as pigs. Oh man, he had some harsh words for his fellow priests. And mostly he had such harsh words for them because they felt like they were up here and the congregation was, not really worth their time. And Luther said, "We are all called to be priests. That is, people who mediate God's love with God's people, between God's love and God's people. That's what a priest is. Someone, anyone, doesn't matter if you're a beautician, doesn't matter if you're, a computer programmer. All of us are priests anytime we mediate God's, between God's love and sharing it in some way with God's people. You know, under this idea of preaching the gospel, always use words when necessary. Any of you who follow our Facebook page, St. Mark's Facebook page, will notice that typically about three times a day, I try and I go through, I get all of this stuff, and much of it is religious and spiritually uplifting, and I try and find what I think might be the three best messages that I think would be good for the people of Brookline to be able to hear, and I put it out on our website. And then anytime someone even just presses like on any of those, I invite them to become a follower of St. John or St. Mark's website, and then send them a list of the things that we intend to do for the next month. So, whatever we do, whoever we are, we are called to be mediators, arbitrators, people like the prophet Habakkuk, and like St. Francis, who receive messages from God, who are messengers of God for all the world. Brothers and sisters, that's a big challenge. But I want you to remember this week, each and every one of you are a messenger of God. Do you know that? People see you walk out of this church, you can go start walking up the street, and you can be either a good messenger or a bad messenger. But remember, you are a messenger of God. And I am blessed to know that each and every one of you are good ones. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, the idea of doing good works so that others might praise you and give thanks to you is rather overwhelming. And yet we humbly seek to accept the task of being your messenger wherever we go, in this community, in our homes, the grocery store, at the salon, at the mechanics where I pray, Lord, you'll fix my car somehow. We call on you so that we, not asking you to do more, Lord, we're asking that we could do more for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Pray together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray together, or let us pray the prayers of the church. God of all, your children everywhere cry out for mercy. Awaken the global church to the urgent needs of our time. Break down barriers of culture and custom and unite people of all faiths in your redemptive and healing work. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of wonder, the earth's beauty and abundance is your gift. Teach us your ways of sharing resources and caring for life. Guard fragile habitats, preserve the wild places, and protect endangered plants and animals. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of peace, you do judge the nations. Beat our weapons into tools for serving the neighbor. Resolve
and strengthen the resolve of all who work for an end to war. We pray for lasting peace in the land of Jesus' birth, in Palestine and in Israel. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of loving kindness, you desire fullness for the life of all people. Fill those who hunger, comfort those who are grieving, bring help to any to whom are sick or needing of your care. Especially today, we remember Diane and Dan and Don. We pray for healing for Jack and Sally, for Kelsey and Crystal, for Chris, Sue, Carol, Alice, Maureen, Tim, Rose, Salim, Sebi, Barb. For Mateo, Judy, Mike, Kenny, Barb, Susan, Della, Dan, Jeff, Jerry, Colleen, David, Cynthia, and Ross. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of community, you are present. You are with us when we gather in your name, whether we want you to be with us or not. Guide congregations in transition or conflict. Give wisdom to congregational councils, call committees, and ministry leaders. In all places, and especially here, Lord, we pray for St. Mark's and our mission and ministry in your holy name. Keep us alert to unexpected opportunities for mission. And be present, dear God, with Nicole, Mark, Brandon, Jeff, Colleen, Evan, Jack, Claire, Dylan, Mark, Pat, Henry, Ginny, those who are traveling, Diana, Tom, Mark, Paul, and Don. And we give you thanks today for Nana and Louise, for family, for friends, for the Lambros family, for God's gift of our Savior, and all the blessings that we receive. God, in your mercy. God of promise, your goodness is everlasting. We give thanks for the lives of the faithful who now rest in you. We trust that you will bring us into the company of all the saints with rejoicing. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all people in all places at all times. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Earth, let us sing, power and majesty, praise to the King. Power to your name. More than our name, we adore at the generation. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Now nothing compares to the promise we have in you. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us pray together the offering prayer. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And in the wonder of the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to the love of the God that we cannot see. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to him we give. Alleluia to the King of Kings, alleluia to the Lamb, alleluia to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am.
And so, people of God, we are reminded that in the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people. Do this for the forgiveness of sin and in remembrance of me." Amen. Let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul. bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Susan, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Gary, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Suzanne, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Jean, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Be the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Paul, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Of Jesus shed for you. Jim, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Carol, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Howie, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Sharon, the body and blood of Jesus shed for you. Body and blood of Jesus shed for you.
Sisters and brothers, let us partake of the gifts that we have received, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may it strengthen us and keep us always in God's grace.
Please stand now for the charge to the people. Sisters and brothers, go out into the world in peace. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Together the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever. Amen. Before I give the blessing, I just wanted to thank our musician Norman, because I talked about changing the liturgy for today, but what I failed to say is that Norman and I met together to do that, and so I want to thank him very much for his participation in that, as we seek to bring a spiritual worship to us as God's people that touches our hearts each season of our lives. Let us continue now, with the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
When
People of God, go in peace and love your neighbor. Thanks be to God. Thank you.